And the thing is, the starts as well. You saw the start, I believe we saw Adaptin over in the solo lane at the beginning of the game, pressuring with Maniac, whereas in the mid lane, we saw Captain Twig joining Pretty Prime, which have provided pressure there on the level one as well. So those stylistic choices of which lane to start off in does influence the game. We'll see if Energy do adapt based off that, or if they're going to run the same thing back to an extent.
Yeah, at the end of the day, it wasn't even picks for me that happened with Energy there. It was just execution.
Yeah.
Obey just looked really strong.
They did look really good, but they did what they needed to. You know, they executed correctly. They got out when they needed to. They aggressed when the situation arose. And the best thing is the team's communication seemed to be all beyond point. When somebody initiated, they were all ready to join in the fight, and it put Energy on the back foot because they were already behind.
Sylvanas and Poseidon going to be banned out by Obey Alliance. They don't want to see Poseidon one more time on Yamen. You saw they were a little bit too far behind for it to be a big impact, but the setup and the execution of those Krakens, he was hitting 3-4 players sometimes. Just unfortunate the numbers weren't adding up. Thoth and the Rattataskr bans, expect to see many of those. And Zeus, the first pick for Obey Alliance, giving Pretty Prime exactly what he wants.
Now, even though Mercury and Artemis are not bad picks from Energy, they are hyper carries and do take a little bit more time to come online sometimes.
Sure.
We may see Energy look to do what they normally do when they lose a game and then bring out the powerhouse gods a little bit more. Something a little bit more early game, maybe some of the transitions to mid game a little bit more. The Mercury, I think I'm fine with. We may see Artemis change up, though. It depends.
I honestly don't think so. Artemis has been one of Emilito's favorite gods for a long time now.
And
even recently, he's been tweeting about how he's kind of just playing Artemis. So.
They need to change something, though, in the grand scheme. Whether it's just a level one start that needs to change overall, the beginning of the game start was the biggest for Energy there.
Sure.
They lost everything across the map in the grand scheme of things, because otherwise everybody's like, well, we'll just run it back. Like, let's run it back. If you guys want to run it back, we're happy to. We did great that game.
Bracken for Maniac, Hamaterasu out there for Amilzy, unless they decide to switch for no reason. Hercules will be the selection for Dimmy this time around. I think that's a good choice. Dimmy on the Sun Wukong was very low impact. Hercules is a high impact character, and I think we can definitely see a lot of it. The Sirket banned out.
Had to be.
Captain Twig didn't win that game for his team, but he was
a big impact player.
That's what I'm saying.
He didn't do it alone, but he was a big impact player in that
absolutely
game.
Absolutely. He's my MVP for game one.
Yeah, you have to look at him because some of the plays that he did make towards the end as well, like the blink onto adapting to get the Sonic Boom and catch that, things like that were very important and integral of making this happen. The Artemis ban for safety from Obey, I really do like that choice.
Yeah, well, if you ask you, it's going to help Energy out even more.
I mean, potentially, it could help Energy out even more. We'll see. We've gone with the Izanami, which is along the same sort of vein, just a little bit better pressure and lane clear here. This could mean that either the dual lane do something differently, and maybe we don't see Rafa actually sit in dual lane at the start. He may go mid, allowing Adaptin to go into the solo and leave Izanami 2v1 with her great wave clear.
I think you're onto something right there, Hinduman. And when it comes down to what Energy have here with the Izanami, I'm actually, this is interesting to me because Izanami has been running in every game, in scrims, in ranked, in casuals. Anytime you turn a stream on, there's at least one Izanami in the game, and yet we haven't seen her all weekend.
We'll say one thing as well, though. That could be a different switch-up. Izanami could go mid, and we could see Vulcan in the dual lane.
That's true.
Not something to guarantee that'll happen with it, like the team like Energy, but it is a possibility they could look at
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. I'm just surprised that it took this long to see Izanami.
We saw a little bit earlier on, but not too much of it. Like, the wave clear is strong for her overall here. That's one of the reasons she's really picked, is the wave clear and the fact that she can just dominate the lane matchups that she can come into just by getting ahead early and having better rotations.
Well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. That's what Obey is saying here. Maniac, Captain Twig, Pretty Prime, Amilzy, and Ataraxia. Everything in the same spot from game number one, except for the jungle position. Sirket was banned out, so Captain Twig has to change things up to his, honestly, signature hood and bats. When Captain Twig, once formerly the mid lane for Fnatic, a mid laner for his entire career, he shifted over to the jungle, pretty much just a P0s, and he kind of leaned on the hood bats for a long time.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know the whole story about Zeros and Captain Twig and how that happened, because Zeros used to be a jungler as well, but I know he wanted to mid.
Zeros just said he wanted to mid, and that's what happened.
Is that all it was?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
it was a pure power play.
So since then, Twig has adapted to be a jungler and done pretty well for himself. Well, look at this start. Did you see that there?
Rapper,
now on the solo side, poked the wave early as it's still running in, so it's taking damage for free, which means it's already weakened. And on the left-hand side, though, Emilito's meeting two Obey members who are looking to... They can't make a decision now, I think. Emilzy was going for one, and Ataraxia another. They will get the little harpies for now. Mid lane, speed buff as well, being invaded by Obey.
Yeah, it's about the zone here coming out from Obey. They just wanted to keep Emilzy out of the conversation, or excuse me, Emilito out of the conversation by way of Emilzy.
And meanwhile, the right-hand side energy are going to invade the speed buff as well in response to the fact that Obey evade in speed and blue. Energy looking to answer back with three members of their own. Okay, we got a ball game now at the start, at least. And only person down, Emilito.
And this is also two big changes here. One, by banning out the Cirquette, you put Captain Twig on his Hunbats. I would have actually rather see the Arachne, believe it or not, because that would have made Energy's ban less impactful. By selecting the Hunbats, you're neutering your ability to invade, and Energy know that. Energy is a team that all five members of these guys are good, but. Hindu, who's the one guy on energy?
The one guy on energy? Adapting is the
exactly.
name that comes to mind, but after time has gone on, we've all said the measures, but adapting definitely is one.
It changes all the time as Maniac is in trouble. This is going to be first blood, Graham.
Quite possibly. He's a little bit tanky, though, with minions still going to run. Oh great
flame.
Pull from Dimi. That's death. That's death, finally. I think he may have got out there for a second with the Vanguard as well.
Yep.
He may have just lived, but the pullback of the Earthbreaker from Dimi needed to be hit.
High impact character, like I said. Dimi poised to make a return. Dimi and, like I said, adapting. I think the one guy on energy is kind of a fallacy. But everybody always points to adapting. And that's who, when going gets tough, energy lean on adapting. They're a team, but they lean on adapting. Last game, he had one speed buff for the entire time. The team shifts their strategy this time around to ensure that this Mercury can get off the ground. Not only adapting, but the character selection as well. They need to assist him in the early game. They've made the adaptation, and that's why they've been so strong historically.
And this is the thing with Season 4 just coming out now, is that all teams are trying to work out what necessarily is the best start overall. You've seen teams take two to the dual lane, two to the solo lane, three to the solo lane, three in the jungle, three in the mid lane. You just don't know what each other's going to do. So wall placements early on, and then recognizing what opposition's doing is very key to adapt for the very next game.
Yeah, it's nice catch coming out onto Emilito from Ataraxia. He's going to be in from behind. Rapper says hello, chases out the beads. And that'll be, honestly, a win for the guys on energy. Chasing out Raxia's beads and being able to heal up and provide support for the Izanami. I'm going to take that one for energy.
Yeah, beads for beads is okay. It's in the grand scheme of things, though, it makes both hunters very aware of that the enemy knows when the cooldown of their beads is now up. Because they use them about the same time. It's one thing you can always do in a fight. Is like, if I use beads and he uses beads, hey, guys, his beads are down for another 5 seconds. Just to let you know, we can go on him now because mine aren't up either.
Exactly. Got to keep an eye on that one. Maniac here trying to hold his own in the lane. Again, playing the Kabrakan this time around.
And Kabrakan, to be fair, is a pretty safe guard in the lane matchup. Most of the Warriors don't really want to build into magical defense as their very first major item. And his burst damage is pretty good in that lane matchup.
So that play right there from Dimi. It's not as silly as chat probably thinks it was. You see this, honestly, a lot of times from Hercules players off of the invade from Obey here
but
in the speed.
That's actually down for this fight now. Emilzy taking a lot of poke here at the moment in a bit
big
of trouble.
Big ultimate. Vulcan's going to chase Emilzy out of that situation. There's the Fear No Evil. Beautiful play coming out from Captain Twig. But is it enough? Flipped up on top, and that's going to be trouble for Pretty Prime, but not before Maniac picks up one. Adapting and Friends answer back. Two players down on the side of Obey Alliance. Maniac's going to be chased to the end of the earth. Whoopee. And he's going to fall down to the hand of Emilito.
Messy fight from both teams there. The best news is for Energy, though. They managed to get themselves in a bit of a better position. They could have potentially caused a couple more problems there, Obey, if they grouped up and picked the same target.
Yeah.
Maniac got juggled around in control there, where he couldn't choose the correct target he was after, the lower health ones. And in the end, Energy walk away relatively unharmed there, apart from the duo lane, where Ataraxia did punish them a little bit until Rapper defends the purple.
Nice little save coming out from Raffer. The Kepri taking the buff away from the
nothing
Uller.
Better. Nothing better as a support player seeing a hunter doing the buff and you manage to secure it against him. There's nothing better than that, just knowing that how much damage they've got. But on the receiving end of that, when you're the one trying to take the buff and you're like, man, my abilities are down and this guy just walked in and used a little bit of damage and stole it. Damn, that feels bad.
Yeah, Raxia. Not feeling bad, despite having no kills to two. He's still above his opponents, Izanami. And we don't have to remind you about the bloodbath that was in game number one.
These oracles are both going to go the way of Obey there. Emilito had to give them up early. around these Oracle fights, you have to reset it a lot earlier than you think. You can't hold on to them too much, because as they're resetting, somebody else can aggro them by being in the pit with them, and you end up losing them. Exactly what happened there. That situation has to be identified a little bit earlier by all the teams going forward here. As Dimmy did a very good pull then, just to deny Maynex some clear. He's not got enough mana for kill here, unfortunately, but it could have been close.
Yeah, he would have had mana for the driving strike in maybe 3 or 4 seconds. Not enough to really confirm the kill. Strong play is coming out so far from Dimmy. Like I said, you give him a character that he can really be a menace on, and he's certainly going to do that. Right side, even interrupting Maniac's back, you see the ultimate from adapting.
But Maniac's still alive. Knowing it's down now, I'm catching Twig on the rotation. The monkey bounce will hit adapting. Fear no evil as well. Overhand smash and smash with the walls from Maniac. Great rotation from Twig.
That was absolutely on point. That's why you saw the hesitation coming out from the guys on energy to really commit. Once adapting hits the ult and goes past Maniac, realizes that support is on the way, and he's got to be out before he's got to be there.
Just solid play from Twig down overall. Yep. Adapting made the gank on solo lane, didn't manage to find the Sonic Boom. He was after on Maniac, and then the rotation from Twig comes in, and he did everything he had to in that perfectly. Throw out the monkey, got in range, picks up the kill.
So I think we it's interesting. Tomorrow, same time at 1 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, we'll be doing the North American broadcast with our four or eight teams, rather, our four matchups. And one of the big trends in North America is a ton of new mid laners that have shifted over from different positions. Now, Captain Twig shifted from mid into the jungle, and this is going to be his second full season in the jungle. And in his first approach was slow. He was all right, right? We gradually got to see him turn better into now. He's a fantastic jungler. I think the mid laners that are transitioning will take a while.
In trouble, surrounded by three, but a big old ult from Yamin will really force back Obey for now. Now they've got to turn tail. Meditate comes in, adapting. Why to commit there, but he saw the Meditate and changed his mind.
Emil D is still the target of adapting. Pretty Prime would be the better target. Can he get there is a different story. Adapting opts instead to turn around. Just boots for him so far. 2-1-1 for the jungler as he just dings level 9. Really troublesome game number 1 for this Mercury. Couldn't get off the ground here. A little bit of a different story, but still not flying just yet.
Gotta say, that was an awkward situation for Energy to be in, but it was Yamin that really came up big for the team there. That Vulcan ultimate denied them getting the red buff steal, which was important, denied them killing Rafa, which would have made it a 4v5 as well, and actually forced Obey to use a meditation defensively to get away from the danger situation. So it was a big win for Energy there.
Energy goes ahead, grabs Emilzy. There's another grab onto Emilzy, tossed into the friendly rainstorm to chase Energy away.
Twig in mid, though, was trying to wrap round. It's going to force Energy into their own jungle. If he can find a good hit here, Twiggy might catch one, but adapting Sonic Boom gets him away, but Yamin's left with a peg leg on his own.
Captain Twig goes ahead, takes away the mid lane, forces out the jungler. The 2-on-1 is successful. Raffer is just surrounded. He's going to be toast as well. Captain Twig off the assist of, well, everybody. And Evelito, underneath his tier 2 tower, will just watch and tell his team, hey, I think they're going to get gold.
It is, because obviously adapting being dead, adapting's ult is down. Sorry, adapting being alive, his ultimate is down. And with Dimmy on the right side of the map, this is a free gold fury the way of Obey again. And they're going to get the gold lead again for the second time in 2 games.
Much different story than game number 1, if you ask me.
I agree.
1991.
This is a normal story you see Energy in. If they're at a deficit and they do lose a game, it's normally by a margin like this with a war of attrition. Not like game 1, which just they've got run over.
And you can expect Energy to be behind. They're a team that, how do I phrase this? They have their moment where they're going to shift into gear, like I put it earlier in the day, in the sense that they don't mind being behind. They don't internalize having a deficit against the enemy team. It's really Energy go out there and they largely play solitaire. They play their own game. Whatever the other team wants to do, so be it. As long as it's not as devastating as it was last game, Energy can look up to a 5,000 gold lead and just say, look, we can come back from this.
They're very good at realizing power spikes, Energy. It's one of the things that they're always good at, whether it's an item power spike for a team member, a relic power spike of it being down or up, or an ultimate power spike of having an advantage.
You know, it's interesting. I've always identified them as being probably, arguably, the best players in the league at that sort of skill set. You know who I think is number 2?
eager, I'd say.
Emilzy himself.
Okay. I mean, Emilzy goes all the way back to Launch Tournament when he was a coach.
Yes.
Let's say not Launch Tournament, Launch of the Pro League, I should say, of Season 1. And he'd had a good time. Maynard's a bit of trouble here, though, left alone. But Twig's hanging around, which is kind of stopping Energy from doing anything happen for the time being.
That's the threat. With the threat of the Fear No Evil right here, Energy know that they're playing on a very dangerous situation.
Yami's to the mid, though. That trade is great for Obey. They realize it was pressure right, so they commit mid and pick up Yamin for free.
Maniac's going to be helped out by the teammates. There's the ultimate from Captain Twig to take down Dimmy. Adapting did wind up taking up the solo lane, but the help from the jungle helped.
Rafa will be missed right now. This was just a good play from Obey again. Yeah. The comp is great from Obey here. Realizing they can split apart and pick two targets at the same time. They win the trade in mid. They go even on the trade in right until the extra rotation comes in from the team that won in the mid lane as well.
This is the side of it. This is the side of Obey that I absolutely expected to excel, and that's exactly what we're seeing. Emilzy and that Araxia, if you're less familiar with Emilzy, I guess, that Araxia certainly has a lot of time in the sun. But Emilzy, he's a younger player that has the same mentality and approach to the game that Ataraxy does. It's all about the strategy. I always go back, you were bringing up the kickoff lands.
Yeah.
Before the Pro League launched, we had lands in Europe and North America, and Emilzy was a coach. He was 14 at the time. He had an iPad. He had an iPad with rotation spots, ward spots, strategies, and then, of course, the notebook of picks and bans, which has become the norm now, but certainly wasn't at the time.
Yep.
That approach to the game is very similar to what Ataraxia does, and they're able to just really control this game from a different perspective than a lot of players approach the game.
And you take out the control now, you can see that they're still trying to exploit the situation with the small lead they've gathered by continuing to try and steal away buffs now in the jungle. Denying
right.
blue from Hercules, very important to do that as the mana cost on Hercules is a little bit more. And when you can see Emilzy's only one level down against Adapting as a warrior support here, it does add added pressure to the team of Energy.
Captain Twig and ult and just completely annihilate Dimmy. 0-2-4. For the Hercules so far, not the strongest performance out of Dimmy.
They're going to try and make a play here, though, Energy, I think, and that's why you see Rafa come in. Yamin's here, Adapted about to come round two with his ultimate prime. Sonic Boom, clean up Captain Twig. Yes, this is a mistake from Obey now. Could be a bit of trouble.
Adapting
over here
eight.
On the left side, he's going to be in trouble. Emilzy is the one that's going to be in trouble. Adapting goes ahead and finds a hit. Still, not confirmed that this is Energy's fight, even though it's 3-on-2, until that
Look at mid lane. Look at mid lane.
Room.
Even though this fight is not going great, they get the tier 1 tower. They're getting a tier 1 tower in the mid lane as well. Energy will pick up a couple of kills on this right-hand side, which isn't the best idea to feed a Mercury, that's for sure.
That's the problem.
But at least they're getting some objectives at the same time.
I'll give you that, sure. You know, sometimes, when you step in a puddle, your white shoes get clean. But at the end of the day, feeding that Mercury is the number one headline that I'm looking at. Mercury now 5-1-2.
Oh,
he's got the booties and he's got the Stonecutter sword. These next couple of items is going to be where Adapting becomes scary, and this can turn around. 13 on the clock and a 3,000 gold lead for Obey.
I tell you what, when you saw Prime near that speed buff then and Adapting was one angle, Dimmy was the other, and you're like, goodbye, Prime. But Adapting didn't notice it, Dimmy didn't notice
it,
and in the end, Prime gets out scot-free. If they watched any, both teams watched this tape, they're like, God, Prime, you got lucky there. You should have been dead for sure.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No vision quite there. As I said, Obey leading by about 3,000 gold, 2,400 to be specific.
And the key now is the next Gold Fury. This next Gold Fury is very important for both the two teams. It reestablishes the lead that Obey had based off how the game's been going so far and make sure that the work that Energy just did is denied. However, if Energy take this next Gold Fury, it brings us back to a square game where we start to look towards hyper carries again as the game continues.
And I mean, you know, even without the hyper carry game, like I said, this is Energy. They are content being 2,000 to 3,000 gold down. There's not a team that can play from behind as if they were even as well as Energy, I think, in the entirety of the league.
For the time being, though, Obey just have to wait for the right moment for this Gold Fury in my eyes and have a fight with Energy again. They're in a good enough position for it. If they actually realize now that Maniac has teleport up and Dimmy doesn't, they can make a play from 5v4 on the left-hand side, which will come into it as well. Or once again, maybe look to pick off Rafa. They've been doing that pretty consistently this game, finding Rafa in awkward spots where he's been isolated and left by his team by either being slightly out of position himself or his team realizing they've had to disengage and left the bug alone.
Yeah, it's been the majority of the situation there. Uller, what do you think? Third item, Fatalis. So Fatalis has been picked up a little bit more. It has 10 penetration on it now. It's not just a passive stick as it once was. So you'll see that purchased more and more. Gold Fury, 30% so far. Raptor's gonna Greg, pretty prime. This is gonna be the start of the fight. Great ultimate from the jungler, but it's just not gonna be enough. Well, over the top dead. Comes to jungler. On the other side, ultimate on Captain Twig controls the team.
On the back, he's adapting, no, looking towards prime, but the burst damage from Obey is too much. Obey charged forward, looking for Yamin as well. And Melzi picks up one as Ataraxia gets another, and now Mercury is on his own. The boulder comes through, one tap on Twig, driving strike. Dimmy will not pick up the kill and be turned on as well. Four members of Energy are dead. Obey, all alive.
The reaction time out of Captain Twig there to hit the beads and make sure to jump away before the inevitable Earthbreaker. Absolutely out of control coming out from the jungle monkey, who's going to pick up his... It's actually a very interesting build path coming out from Hunbats. All the items are exactly what you might expect, but kind of in a weird order. Why the CDR late after the power? Well, do you have an idea?
I just want to see if Adapting, first of all, is going to try and really contest this. I mean, this is a breaking point of the game. If Obey get this Fire Giant, Energy's in a lot of trouble here, but I think Adapting's just doing enough by standing here to slow this down.
Yeah, he's definitely slowing it down with Raptor showing up. This is a big situation. Fire Giant going to help out, get some knockups, but Adapting will be the one to fall. Raptor follows up quickly. Emilzy is on the retreat, but the damage has already been done.
Fire Giant still aggro, though, is the key here, and the sustain from Emilzy is coming into play too. Fear no evil to zone out Dimmy, but Vulcan ultimate's not in time, and Ataraxia's Aegis keeps him alive.
Obey just have the lead. They have the Fire Giant, and they have to get the hell out of here. Ultimate out of Dimmy over the wall and hits Maniac in the noggin. Solo laner will fall down. Four players on Obey still with the Fire Giant intact. Energy cannot respond. 5,000 gold behind plus the FG. Things are looking bleak for the defending world champs.
I'm not used to this. I'm not used to ever seeing Energy in this spot so much where I'm like, oh my, they really might lose this set. Are they really gonna lose it? Even at Worlds, I never really felt to myself, oh my, they might lose this set. Right now, oh my, might lose this set.
We have been focusing on Obey for good reason. I think that Obey, my two cents, Hindu, is that I think Obey is doing very, very well here. But what's different on the side of Energy? What's the problem here?
I don't think there is a huge problem on the side of Energy. This is both teams trying to work out what the strategy is. It's a warm-up at the start of the season to an extent. Spring Split has just come online. You're still learning the new season. The biggest take-home I can say from this game, and the game one as well, is the Amaterasu. Now, I don't want to say I didn't think it was the Amaterasu at first, but this mobility, this sustain that she's bringing to the roster is actually really impactful in these teamfight skirmishes when you're playing at the top level.
I'm going to go on the other side of things, and I want to see how you feel about this. I don't see the same impact that MVP Yamin. I don't see him having the same impact in these two games that we have in the past.
Well, game one and game two, he's both hit his ultimates and pretty much on point when he's had to.
Sure.
But he's not really had the support because the pressure is not as much around holding hands with a mid laner as much as it used to be.
But I'll tell you this, you know, on the Vulcan, sure, Poseidon is a playmaker early. And we just didn't see those plays get made.
Can be, but like I said, if the focus is not on the mid lane anymore and elsewhere, finding the Whirlpool Krakens on two or three targets isn't as easy until you've got the setup and they're all grouped together.
Sure.
If everyone's rotating the map a lot more, we've seen Prime this game's gone 1-1-10. Mid laners right now, there's not as much focus on killing them or focus on them making big plays.
True.
It's around the team now. Keep an eye on the Hunters now and the Junglers again. Junglers are always going to be the part.
Yeah.
But the Hunters are now involved in this as well.
Maniac in trouble here, gets controlled by the solo lane. Wall not going to be strong enough.
It's fine.
Adapting able to put him down. 6-2-3 here.
Tier 1, tier 2, 4. Maniac. And Maniac didn't have the Fire Giant there, if I remember correctly, because he just died at the end of the Fire Giant engage already. So they don't even lose a Fire Giant buff off that. They get the cleanup of the Oracles on the left as well. Great work from Obey just to continue to keep Energy at bay. This is great.
Energy at bay. By Obey.
At bay by Obey. I didn't intentionally rhyme.
Hey,
my bad. Now Energy have got basically sit back and wait for Phoenixes here. I don't think they can really look to defend tier 2 towers whatsoever. The tier 2 towers is not an option.
I think
really
you can. If I'm Energy, because of the fact that you have the Vulcan, I think that you can go ahead and defend the Tier 2 tower. The Vulcan and the Hercules here. I think if Hercules gets a pick that flips player onto the tower, driving strike, all of a sudden you have the 4-on-5. And the fact that Yamen has the turret and the meatballs, a lot of decent, not just long-range poke, but long-range disruption. I think that you can defend on a Tier 2 tower. It's just a matter of can energy execution. Get there before Obey.
Execution is difficult of it, but it is the world champ, so their execution should be at the
exactly.
highest of the game.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, this Tier 2 on the right is already about to fall down by Ataraxia. The knockup was good, but he hit the wall though, but the Milzy's going to tank this up. But Dimmy's body blocking a lot of this, as the Milzy goes straight onto Yamen on the other side, and in comes Twig.
Oh, that's control. That's going to put Raffer down right there. Ultimate out of Yamen. Little bit off the mark, just going to barely nick one player. Not a enough. Dimmy's in trouble! Captain Twig putting him in detention.
Two members down now on the side of Energy, with Maniac now up on the front lines as well. He can tank up a little bit with a minion wave coming in. The Phoenix on the right is going to fall here for Obey. The Fire Giant has worn off, and off the back of that, that was a good victory for Obey overall.
Yeah, they're still going to make the play for the Tier 2 tower. Absolutely no reason to not go for this one.
Yeah.
If Energy want to respond, Obey's over 10 grand up. They can take the fight, but realistically, Energy, I like the defense on the other side. It just didn't work. I don't like the defense here. Neither does Energy. They'll slink back and wait for the Phoenix fight.
The world champs are about to get beat. After 2 years.
Hey man, the game's not over. Plenty of smite to be sung. Don't sell your fish before they're in the boat.
I mean, the fish are in the boat. The fish are in the boat right now. I'm already on the phone right now going, hey guys, is anyone buy my fish? That's how confident
I am. I don't know about that. You gotta go, you gotta get, you
and
gotta
then,
deal
and
with
then
tariffs.
If something goes wrong, I'm on the phone going, hello, lag? Hello? Oh, DC, sorry, I can't say the fish no more because they're not on the boat anymore.
Oh, okay. That's how that works?
Safety feature, safety
right.
feature.
Jermaine number two over here. Trouble for Maniac in the corner. He's gonna get driving struck. And here's Raffer. Maniac surrounded by energy jerseys.
Awkward.
Bad spot for Maniac, but here comes the help. An ultimate out of Captain Twig will control too. Maniac looking to get out, looking to help now. And I have no idea how Maniac got out.
Scuffle for the detonate, and Ataraxia's here to clean up as well. Being alongside and Milzy on the left-hand side, looking for Emilito. He's going to pick up a killer's Twig cleaned up as well. That could be game.
Is that game?
I think so.
That's game by F6. That's game by F6. That's game by F6. Energy Esports lose one of their first ever split sets. You are so excited about this.
I'm excited because no one likes winners. I'm gonna be honest. No one likes winners that win all the time. Everybody hated Cog Red because they won all the time.
I like
everyone
Cog
hated
Red.
Cog Prime because they
like
won all the
Cog
time.
Prime.
That's why nobody likes you, because you always like these teams that win.
Because I win all the time. All I do is win. That's what I do. That's going to be it for us here on the desk. Well, theoretically the desk. We had an awesome set. Really cool to see Energy actually drop the ball for once ever. Just a change of pace. And for a change of pace, let's take it away from us and toss it to Taco.
Thanks so much, Efton and Hindu. And boy, oh boy, what a set from Obey. I don't know about you guys back home, but I don't think any of us saw this coming today. But there is a little bit of satisfaction when you watch the underdog story. I mean, you've got Pretty Prime and Ataraxia. You know, they've always been trying to find their way back to that Titan spree, but they found it here today with this new lineup. And I'm still a little bit speechless, to be honest, seeing NRG even fall in such a way, because Obey didn't just win. They completely dominated NRG in both of these games. I can't even remember the last time we've seen NRG lose and split sets before, but watching them fall behind by 10K, 12K gold deficits, that's something that none of us are ever accustomed to seeing. And I mean, Obey, they came out to play. They came out swinging. They just had pure map control from the get-go, and it really came to show, especially on the side of Ataraxia, on this Uller. Something about Ataraxia where he's that guy that just always has to play the hunter that nobody else is playing and make sure that he's coming out on top with it. Early on, he went ahead and secured an easy first blood double kill for himself in that first game, and that should have been foreshadowing for what was to come on the side of NRG, and they were probably sweating as soon as that happened because they knew that Ataraxia was definitely going to be coming up big. But not to be left out, Twig, of course, comes out as well on this Sir Kett. Such an excellent performance from Captain Twig, putting so much pressure onto Dimmy in that solo lane, really helping Maniac ensure that he was maintaining a lead and feeling super confident in his return to the competitive scene. I mean, just overall, complete and pure domination from Twig. He I don't want to say it's the downfall of the king, but he just got dethroned by Captain Twig in both of those games. And I've got to say, great job to Obey picking up that first set. And also, great job to them in securing the second game win, where they had the same kind of dominating performance as the first. Normally, we're accustomed to seeing NRG go ahead. If they lose a set, they're going to come back and just stomp on you. But that was not the case with Obey. Once again, they just pure devastation to NRG. They had no response whatsoever to Obey, securing early gold leads once again, early XP leads. And actually, it was a little bit closer from the get-go. It looked like NRG were going to do their standard, you know, you beat us, sure, fine, but we're going to control the game from here on out. But Obey just had zero issues responding. They went ahead and made sure to come back out on top after a bit of an awkward start, considering that a lot of pressure was being applied onto Maniac in that solo lane. But they also just, they did not leave him hanging in the slightest. They went ahead, Maniac, you know, it's a little bit awkward when you're trying to run back the Gabrakan. You know that the king's going to be camping you. But you could see right away, he's just going ahead and responding, juking out everything from adapting. And then he's got Captain Twig, his boy, backing him up, going ahead, easy cleanup for Maniac. And just securing the kills all around. He was also an excellent factor as far as the teamfight control is concerned, because of the fact that he was consistently using his wall to ensure that NRG had as much chaos in their backline as possible. And the stuns from the Gabrakan are also pretty devastating to teamfight scenarios, considering when they're trying to escape, they just can't. And this final play, the game-winning sealing of the deal for Obey, pretty, I mean, we're not used to seeing NRG lose. We are much less accustomed to seeing them lose via F6, but Obey found a way to make them do it. And speaking of Obey, we've got somebody that we haven't talked to in a long time that I'm excited to talk to today. Maniac, how's it hanging, buddy?
Hey, what's up? How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good, thanks. I'm sure you're doing pretty good, too, after that set.
I mean, yeah, I couldn't be happier. I mean, I haven't been playing on the SPL for almost, like 9 months, about that, since Season 3, so... And we came up with a really strong win, so, I mean, I couldn't be happier.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to have been playing a lot, grinding it out on the side, right? There's no way that you just take this huge hiatus break from Smite, and then out of nowhere, you just come in playing Gabrakan as if you've been like a day one solo laner from the get-go.
Okay, I think there's a misconception here. I mean, I kind of stopped playing competitively, but I still play Smite on the side here and there.
Yeah.
And I kind of stopped playing Smite a lot, I mean, a lot. In November, December, so I hear people saying that I haven't played the game for a year, which is incorrect. Mostly FDOT, I'm looking at you. I know you like me, I'm the Portuguese powerhouse, man, but you just made a huge mistake there, okay? So, apart from that, yeah, I've been playing a lot. Scrims, ranked pretty much all day, I try my best, and yeah, I mean, I guess we just showed the results here.
Hey, I mean, all that hard work is definitely paying off for you. You looked absolutely phenomenal, especially, like, just... Honestly, congratulations, man, for making that your debut back into the SPL. I think you played great. Is there any shout-outs that you want to go ahead and give?
Yeah, sure. I mean, first of all, to my teammates, which without them I couldn't have got this win, of course, and to Obey, which are a really good organization. And yeah, pretty much. Thank you.
All right. Well, congratulations once again. That was Maniac, the new solo laner for Obey, for those of you who missed it. And man, what a set. What a day in general. I mean, let's go ahead and take a look at all the teams and how their standings currently lay after today's big debut of the Smite Spring Split. And you can see right away, Obey, the Helen Squadron, Team Dignitas all coming out on top with clean 2-0 wins. Elevated Nova Sorsa coming out with a split, but you know, they still did a pretty great job themselves in ensuring that, if anything, at least they picked up a point. But man, oh man, is it going to be a pretty exciting split watching how the rest of these weekends unfold with these three teams, because I don't know if it hasn't been made clear yet already, but it's very obvious that anything can happen, and first place is going to be anybody's game after today's showing. That's one thing that I'm more than confident about. But of course, that's not the only thing that's going to be happening. Right here, again tomorrow, same time, we're going to be having North America make their big debut back into the Spring Split. And it's pretty exciting to say the least. I'm especially looking forward to that game between Eager and Soar, considering that there's been a bit of a roster mix-up on Soar. So it'll be pretty exciting to say the least, watching them come out against Eager, who's also been a pretty dominant force. Luminosity as well. I know a lot of you are looking forward to seeing these mid laners and all their switch-ups, Baskin in particular, and how he's going to handle this new role. So overall, guys, I hope that you enjoyed the games for today. I know that I did, and like I said, what a way to end it. Be back here tomorrow. Make sure you're here 1 o'clock p.m. High Res TV, and it'll be a great one. See you guys later.